So as it comes up, I would like to introduce myself. As I said, I am the director of programs for the Creative Computing Institute. I also have a very multidisciplinary background from computer science, design, and also business. And I'm, as a director of programs for the Creative Computing Institute, I lead the current, which are 9 undergraduate and postgraduate courses, and of course our new 6 new courses from September, and including the Creative Robotics, the BSc and the MSc in Creative Robotics. My own background is actually I also started from virtual reality. So working back in 1996 in Germany after my PhD in, at Fraunhofer on projection-based virtual reality. So when it was a room-sized type of experience. And that later on continued when I was a professor of computer science in post-apartheid South Africa. Doing work by bringing African painting into VR and some of interactive stories from the apartheid era. Then back into the UK, I introduced the first augmented reality, working with the BBC, productions that got the television award, the Royal Television Award. And I continue to work with virtual reality. This is what I was doing during COVID, opening up high-end virtual reality to performers that were locked in their homes like us, and giving them the opportunity to feel as if they are physically and visually in a concert hall and perform from that with the acoustics of the concert hall. So that is a similar journey, like starting very from virtual reality and augmented reality and moving into robotics when I was doing my MRes in design in the Royal College of Art. And that's one of the soft robotics we've done when I was there. It was picked up by Wired, and we had an interview about, at that time, it was about autonomous cars, it was about Uber and the sort of the pressure on drivers and their well-being. I continue to do research in robotics and creative robotics. And what I will do today is that I will talk to you about the visiting professorship that I had and the research that I've done in Japan with the University of Tokyo. And I'll talk in the specific research we have done in Tokyo later in the afternoon. But this morning, I want to just give you a feeling for what those 2 months felt for me, this total immersion in the robotics in Japan. I've been in Japan several times, but I wanted to go and spend that time with this big question: what makes robots more readily accepted in the Japanese society, and how can we learn from those insights? Is there some way that that can feed into the way we teach our students creative robotics or how we design robots in the West? And then ultimately, what can we learn from each other, both in Japan and also here? So that's what I'm going to do today, this morning. Bear with me because that was about 5,000 images and photo and videos, and not all fits in 20 minutes that this talk will be about. But I'll try to really try and give you my feeling about what this question is. Why is it so readily accepted in Japan in terms of robotics? So I was visiting a professor in the DLX Design Lab with Professor Miles Pennington. This was funded by the Institute of Industrial Science. This is one of the largest university-attached institutes, research institutes in Japan. The DLX lab is one of 120 research labs that belong into this IIS. And it's leading institute in terms of engineering. I was joined the DLX team, which has a mission to use design to turn science into deployable innovations. And this is the team I joined. And that team supported me into visiting several institutions across the across Japan, some in Tokyo, some in the University of Tokyo, in other universities, but also I visited companies that work with robotics or produce robotics, and with artists, and several places that are not all mentioned in this slide. I went to exhibitions, and this photograph is one example from Professor Yamanaka's exhibition in the University of Tokyo, visiting it together with another world-renowned roboticist, Professor Ishiguro. So I will share with you a few of my insights around and from all those visits. And for those that maybe listen to us from Japan, I'd like to thank you for your time that you gave me so generously when I visited your labs. I want to frame it first, though, because the way that Japanese society is thinking about robots and or AI is slightly different to what we think about in the West. And I can't think of a better way to frame this talk this morning from these words. You see, Japanese see intelligence as a continuum. So sometimes, you know, the robot or the AI is ahead, sometimes the human is ahead, sometimes a dog might be ahead. They definitely know how to smell a lot better than any human or any robot, at least at this point. So there isn't the dichotomy of robots and humans that we have in the West. Somehow Japanese society thinks that in a continuum. So keep that in mind as you hear me talking about all these visits. As I said, I've been in Japan several times, but what made me really want to go back and research robotics in particular was this exhibition in Japan House, Prototyping in Japan. And that's where I saw this mesmerizing work by Professor Yamanaka, where the intelligence was in the body. The intelligence was in the way that the robotic components have been put together or 3D printed together. Their movement was not coming from any AI. It was a very embodied intelligence. As with humans, there is some calculation that is happening in the brain, but there is a lot of calculation that is happening in the body in a much more embodied intelligence. And we'll hear more about that in an afternoon keynote speaker from Imperial College. So that's the reason that I wanted to go and explore even more this type of robotics in Japan. And this was the first lab that I saw. It's actually in the same building as the DLX lab. And this is some work from current students. And again, you can see how movement happens without necessarily having a computation or programming it. It is programmed within the way that these materials work and move together. And I think that's the first message that I've learned, is that somehow, you know, robotic intelligence in Japan is even more so used by finding the intelligence in the material, in the object itself, very physical, very embodied. The next question that usually I'm asked here in the West, we ask the question, well, robots become better than humans. Is AI overpassing us? And that's not necessarily a question that I've heard a lot in Japan. Because again, as I said, they're thinking in a continuum. Let's see one example of where a robot is surpassing us. This robot is playing scissors, hard paper scissors, rock paper scissors, right? It does it with 1, 2, 3, obviously. It doesn't do it with the usual way. And you cannot win it. It's impossible to win. So it's already ahead. And why it is ahead? Well, there is no complex AI. There is no machine learning in this. It has eyes in a way that are faster and more accurate than the human. So the robot is using high-speed, high-resolution cameras, and that's how it's ahead of the human. So before you even try to form one of the rock, paper, scissors, the robot has seen it. It already knows what you're trying to do and can outspeed. And that's one example where obviously robot is ahead. But take the saxophone robot on the other hand, on the other side, on the right-hand side here. That's from Waseda University, a very well-known university for robotics research as well in Tokyo. And that's, I think the saxophonist is still a little bit ahead. It's quite difficult to form that intelligence in the materials to blow in the certain way. Again, this is research that involves very much a physical material, the knowledge and the programming of blowing through artificial mouth. So the question is not whether the human is better or the robot is better. It's more a question of learning with the human. And that's an example of Nagai-sensei, Professor Nagai's lab, where she's exploring and teaching robots by having humans teach them, not AI. It is a very joyful experience that I had there, and you can see it in my smile. I was teaching that robot, I was drawing, and the robot was learning from my drawing. It was almost like teaching a three-year-old how to paint a house, how to draw shapes, different shapes. And of course, the robot was starting to recognize what I was drawing and was learning how to draw a house and recognize that when I was drawing it. So there is this emphasis in learning with the human within the research that I've experienced in Japan. There is also research to explore how we might be more than human. And when I normally say that in conferences, the immediate association is we becoming Robocop, or we becoming, you know, with more limbs, or we, and that's not what this research lab is doing. This research lab is looking to see how our senses might be slightly different if we incorporate robotics to it. So this example, they are looking to see, so what you see there, sort of just hanging there, is two robotic arms. And they are powered by feet. So they were looking to see how is it possible for someone, obviously, that needs to use their feet to operate hands. And what does that mean for the brain? How do you teach your brain to use your feet to actually manipulate objects with artificial robotic arms? And that kind of research can be a lot of fun as well, as I found out when what they have there is the same kind of artificial limbs, but they are paired. So the one on the right is controlling the one on the left. And what happens if you harness two people onto these two things? It is kind of a ballet. So imagine that the person on the right-hand side can actually control the hands of the other person and on the left-hand side. How can we work together as humans and together with robots in that kind of experience? And these, of course, have technical applications. When it comes to factory floors where humans need to control machines and creating interfaces that are more engaging and natural for the humans involved. I was also very fortunate to go and meet Erica. Any hands, how many of you might have seen Erica or have seen pictures of this humanoid in the room? Quite a few hands out here. It's well famous. It's one of the first humanoids that were used from Professor Ishiguro, who his robot, his humanoid is on the left. That's another humanoid. I was very interested when I visited his lab. I was actually greeted in the reception by Erica, or a replica of Erica. And you know how you go there and you are about to meet one of the most important, you know, roboticists in Japan. And you sit there thinking, I am behaving as if this is a receptionist, a human. At the same time, I'm sort of extremely curious about this humanoid. Can I go close to it? Can I actually poke? Is it an object? And am I seen? Where is the camera? It made me think a lot more about my behavior as a human and also the relationship to that robot more than any other visit I have done in Japan. And Professor Ishiguro says exactly that about his research. It's about humans, and it's about actually researching the human more than researching the robot. And I've seen that across all the visits that I had in Japan. There is a much conscious understanding that the research that people do or the robots that they make are really about understanding humans more and questioning that what is human? And yes, I was observed. The actual etiquette at the reception was operated by a human. I later met an autonomous Erica having a very normal chat in Japanese, unfortunately, but I had a translator. And it was fascinating to see the deep AI that was behind this conversation of having small talk, having an Erica robot having small talk with applications for lonely people, for the elderly. There's lots of applications of this, but the research is really what makes us human. And what happens when you have many of you in the world? Imagine that. But I want to go beyond human because I don't think that this example can actually happen in the West. This is a Buddhist monk. So this humanoid is also designed by Professor Ishiguro. It's in Kyoto, it's in a temple. It has a very much virtual reality projected people in there, and I'll show that in a moment. But the whole point of actually this being even possible is because this idea that an avatar can be transported into an android body is something that feels natural in Japan, is not an issue culturally, but also in terms of feeling comfortable with this. And maybe I wanted to just replay the video. It is set in a context of interacting with virtual people, and I think that's important. So there was this feeling that there was crowd there, there were interacting questions, although it was a fully controlled and orchestrated, of course, experience, so that it's possible to interact with a humanoid. It was also very much on purpose that the humanoid was clearly a robot, so some of the parts were visible, and that was important for the whole experience. So that's almost going beyond human, or using a humanoid to transport human bodies or non-human bodies in this case. There was a lot of exhibitions where I went to where there was speculation about living together, a speculative symbiosis with robotics. And I think that's also part of the story. It's not just the research or the company that the companies that do really high-end robotics in Japan. It's somehow embedded in the sort of in fashion, for example, or in motorcycle. This is Prototype Inc., and they are quite famous for their fashion shows. They speculate around how the new motorcycles of the future will be and how we're gonna live. Robotic face masks will help us survive the toxic environment that we are creating in this planet. Finally, industrial symbiosis. I was these photographs and videos come from Ujin. It's a Japanese American company, high-end robotic arms and very much robotic automation in factories. This was a caged experience where the human, of course, wears a helmet and it's within the compounds of secure space. The robots themselves were coordinating in a fascinating dance. So how would that dance involve humans as well? It was my question when I was going through this. And another embodied experience was, you know, robots, this is, in the middle you have a Simo. A Simo is about this high. A Simo was entertaining in the Science Museum for decades, and now he's retired. That's the picture of a Simo in the Science Museum exhibition. What you see on the left and the right images is me controlling a robot. It's a 3-meter robot. It's quite dizzying for a person of my height to all of a sudden be in 3 meters high and with so much power, because I could control quite a strong dynamic robot. All this experience are something that the public can go and have. So this is from the Science Museum. And it's very important that there are exhibitions and robots that you can use in terms of everyday life, go and experiment with them. I'm running a little bit. And talking exoskeleton. There is, this is not a robot, okay? So this is a human moving an exoskeleton, a skeleton. And that's when you start questioning what is robot. But the most important thing is that this is how. So there is games, there is a whole, there is whole football, sorry, there is all boxing matches. People don these skeletons. They are quite difficult to control. It needs a lot of power, physical power, to actually move this skeleton and become so much bigger and so much more powerful. And it's cult in Japan. There are boxing races, and also the company is very successful internationally. So there is something we all know about Japanese robots. They are very cute, and they are very cute. It's almost impossible to make a robot that is not very cute in Japan. We tried. I'll show you examples where in the afternoon where we tried. But that's what makes them really ultimately really engaging. So I wanted to say that this stems really from the fact that Japanese feel that robots are like an alter ego. That's what I've learned. It's very similar to their manga and their comic strips, and we know that there's plenty of publications around this. Back from 1952, it's the Atom Boy, and that's again is a way of introducing robots that are almost our extension. They are almost part of human. Also, the next one, Docker-Ramon in 1970s is exactly the same idea. And I've heard that again and again, that robots somehow feel like part of our alter ego. And that's very different to the robot images that we have in the West, and Exterminator being one of them. So I'll finish with three applications, because I think it's important to understand why then this mentality, that kind of framework, and the ability to see robots as an alter ego allows for applications to happen in Japan in slightly different ways. So this is a robot for well-being. It's a robot that behaves like a pet in a situation where you cannot have a pet because of living in a flat, or you're elderly and you would love the joy of having a pet, but it is just a bit too much. It will. I think the video says it all. The more you interact with it, it will purr, it will make noises, and it will grant you joy by moving its tail. The CEO that created Yukai Inc. Says that he sold his previous company, a typical tech entrepreneur, to bring fun to the world through his robots. And that's his mission, to make robots that bring fun, they bring laughter, they bring joy. The second application is about accessibility, I mean, inclusive and accessible society. This is the avatar in a totally different way than the film that we imagine. This is a cafe, so it's a cafe where anyone can go and have coffee. There is a little avatar robot in the side of that, in every table, and this is connected to a human. A human that cannot works from home because due to disabilities they were not able to come out and work in the cafe itself, and they talk and interact with you while having coffee. So this is a way again of bringing humans into a space where they might not be able to, and creating a more inclusive society. And finally, the last one I want to talk about is an example of how robots can really help our planet. This is an indoor strawberry farm. Strawberries is an art, is a science, and they're the most delicious, most amazing strawberries I've ever had. And the, not just from this farm, but I mean in general, it's an art in Japan. And this one is an indoor farm for strawberries. The problem with indoor farms is that usually they use bees, and bees don't survive. There isn't enough pollen, there isn't enough for them to feed. So indoor farming for bees means death by starvation. And this is what they're trying to remedy, using a robotic trained to go and pollinate better than humans. So usually you can do that by, as a human, but the robot, this robot is managing with this company, which is a spin-off from the University of Tokyo, is actually having a better pollination rate than humans. And similar to bees. I'd like to summarize and say this is what I've learned. So I've learned that, first of all, Japan is a wonderful place to do this kind of research because they do have a different frame for the way they look at robots. The socioeconomic drivers also create a positive relationship with robotics, and they see humans creating an intelligence continuum that can find solutions to societal issues. The more about studying, so research in robotics is the typical research that we expect, but also it's a lot about researching the human rather than the robot. And finally, robots are seen as alter ego, and therefore it opens up applications like the Avatar Cafe. It opens up access to society and inclusive, and creating a more inclusive society. The way that I can link that kind of philosophy, if you like, in the West is a lot around post-humanism and vibrant matter philosophies. And that's where I think we have a lot to learn from each other. I'd like to thank, first of all, the Professor Miles Pennington and the DLX team for supporting me in actually visiting all these places, all the people that so generously donated their time for me to go and be there. Thank you very much.